How's your trading been going the last few weeks?
What's going on, guys?
Hell yeah.
Are you in a new spot?
Good to see you again.
What's up?
Are you in a new spot? Just move stuff around?
No. Well, I think the last time we recorded, where was I?
You were in your other place. You're in New York now.
Was I? No, yeah. So I might have been in Florida at that time.
Ew, I hate Florida.
It's got its taxes are better than New York, but it's got its good things, its bad things. Just depends, I guess, what you're into.
Really. I just hate the humidity. I'm just being a bitch.
No, the humidity is horrible. I used to work at this law firm, and I had to wear like a tie and everything, and a dress shirt. And then you would go outside. I'd be inside, and then I would go out in the middle of the day for lunch or whatever, and it's like 2, and then automatically just dripping
your pits
sweat
would be soaked.
Yeah, dude, you get the back still, it's like my back comes going. I get in the car,
that shirt changes colors
up against my and then the thing is, that's why you're supposed to wear an undershirt, so if you do sweat, it doesn't leak through to your button down. But in Florida, who wants to wear an undershirt underneath your button down with a tie? I mean, it was.
Then your nipples are sticking out.
Oh no, that happens when you go back into the building with the air conditioning.
Oh yeah.
Then you get mad cold, and then
they get chafed. You chafe your nipples up. Then they go from hot to cold too much.
Yeah, that's serious chafing issues in all areas, and
you need some gloves.
I don't miss that. Cold?
The thing that runners use, they put it on their nipples so it doesn't chafe.
Oh yeah, that reminds me of that one in the office. Remember,
it's called Glade or Glide or something like that, bro. You like swipe it on your nipples if you get sweaty, and so that your shirt doesn't like rub it.
Never
much.
Heard of that, bro.
No, that was like that Office episode, where they're doing the marathon for rabies, yeah. And he's like, I got sensitive nipples. I need to stop the chafing. And he's got he puts like tape. He puts like medical tape on his nipples.
Isn't that when Michael Scott is eating like fettuccine or something?
Yeah, he's like, okay, got a carb load. And he starts puking all over his
head. Oh, dude, that's such a good show. I forget how good that show is until you watch it. Yeah, for real.
Well, that's a good opening.
Yeah, there we go. Interesting. We're really going off the deep end right now.
I just want to let everyone know I've been slamming some Manhattans, and I had an old fashioned earlier, so I'm a few too many deep. I hope you guys are too. It's going to be fun. We're going to have a good time.
Teddy being Teddy,
people in my Discord were like, try this new whiskey, and I think I tried it a few too many times, and it's only 7:19 where I'm at, but. Whatever, man. How's trading been the last few weeks for you?
Yeah, trading. I mean, wow, what a market, and
today was crazy.
Look at these swings. I think, we did have some technical difficulties last time we traded this, but I think our last time we recorded this, but I think the day that we recorded this, I think that was the day that we saw SPY down, what was it, 4%, and then it ended in green. So, so we're still in that, that wild market. I think that the swings have, calmed down a bit. but they certainly been pretty incredible. I mean, still $6-7 ranges, you know, on the day. So there's been a lot of opportunities to make a lot of money, you know, on either side. But it's been good. It's been good. You know, I think for me, it took me, you know, whenever we get into a different, basically season of volatility or a different cycle of volatility, I think that, you know, that's a better word, it takes me, you know, maybe a couple of days to adjust and to kind of reformulate what I need to do. But once I got, you know, in sync with the market, it's been pretty good. Not too bad.
Yeah, it's definitely presented a lot of opportunities. I know there's been a lot of downside opportunities. Like today, there was a massive downside opportunity. If you caught it at the right time, that delayed CPI. I know you tweeted a little bit about that. And actually, that was one of the things that tipped me off. Like, maybe this is a delayed reaction to the CPI, because CPI today was not good. But market was up crazy in the first 30 minutes.
I know. Because it was just selling motoring. Up and then it just shot right up. I'm like, what is going on here? But Bullard, you know, the Fed, the St. Louis Fed, they would call him, I think, the hawk of the Midwest. He came in with some spicy comments and blessed, because I'm actually swinging some puts for March. And they were getting manhandled over the last couple of days. I think I posted, you know, some bearish stuff, some bearish charts, and all this. And sure enough, like the next day, you know, it rallied up for like 2 or 3 days straight. But, you know, I was holding my thesis. But, you know, it's funny too, because I got monthly March puts, and, you know, usually if you don't want as much volatility in your contracts, you know, you go with, you know, monthlies, you know, instead of weeklies. But these things, I was up 50% at one point, down to 40% at another point, 25% at another point, 15%, and today they actually closed green, you know. But I had conviction, you know, on them, and you know, I alerted to the sharks that, you know, this is still going to be a smaller trade, because, you know, to deal with the volatility, you know, because I had a feeling we could see something like, you know, what happened. But yeah, it's been a wild time. A lot of opportunities. I know it's hard for a lot of new traders to deal with the volatility. So, you know, I do know a lot of people are struggling right now, but that's when sizing, you know, can definitely come into play as far as helping deal with these swings, you know, cutting down, don't go in your normal size. And that way, you know, cut out a little emotions and be able to, if you're on the wrong side, you know, you'd be able to handle it or get out with less collateral damage.
Yeah. I know we were talking a bit about inflation on the last episode, which no one saw, because somehow my
thing turned into a transformer.
So, yeah, some reason our audio turned into like robot, and we couldn't get it salvaged. But a question I had was, a lot of things like report came out today, and a lot of people have been tweeting, talking about how inflation is going to decrease in the second half of 2022. And CPI came out today. It was kind of nasty. You know, we were over what was expected. But do you see inflation decreasing? Because I don't see any reasons. Like, I see the government coming out with inflation to decrease. Or I see...
Yeah, I saw there was a headline on CNN about it today.
Do you see any reason why inflation could decrease?
Well, I mean, you know, as they start to tighten, you know, I think, you know, it technically could potentially, but they've already printed so much money. It's like, you know, we're really kind of behind the curve. I mean, they said that, you know, I saw that they're speculating for 50 basis point, you know, raise, but honestly, it's almost too little too late. They probably need 75 or 100, but, you know, I think the Fed is too aware of their effect on the market. You know, if they raised it, you know, for 100, the market would be like, but it's probably what they actually need to do, to be honest, you know, to catch up with it. I mean, if they even can, you know, we're dealing with kind of really more macro type of, you know, topics, you know, which also take longer to play out. You know, you could say inflation is going to go down, and at the end of the year, maybe not. You know, but these things and the consequences of printing, all the money and having the monetary policies that we have, they have effects that are way longer than even that we could even anyone could predict. So I think it's really still too speculative to make a definitive answer on whether they might cool down some, but remain elevated, and then it's really going to depend on what the Fed does. The other big thing to watch is the yields right now. I think they were hovering at 2%, and it's really important to keep an eye on the Treasury yields, because if they go up, that puts further pressure on the markets, and especially on tech, and SPY, and especially QQQ isn't going anywhere with yields like that. So at least for the short term, my bearish thesis is intact. We'll see what happens. Either way, my puts expire in March, so that was as long as I was willing to predict out to. So we'll see what happens. We had a pretty weak close today, obviously. So we're back below the 9 and the 20 on the daily. I got to check on the weekly. I think the weekly's still hanging in there. We still have some more room down to get under the. I think we're under the 50 on the daily again, but we're still over the 200. We did reclaim that, so. It's anyone's guess. I hope for my put sec, I hope the market goes down, but I would like inflation to ease because everything's so damn expensive. Yeah.
Oh, dude, it's ridiculous.
But
the groceries,
bacon's like $10.
Yeah, bacon.
yeah. I heard the meat prices that went up. Everything's a lot more expensive. So, and that's hurting a lot of families, and that's hurting a lot of people. With limited incomes, and it's really strange right now too, because obviously we have a labor supply shortage as well. People, that employers can't find people to work, because they don't want to work for these cheaper wages. So yeah. We're kind of stuck in a really interesting place that certainly will be studied and looked at for many years to come. When this is all over 50 years later, wherever we are, we'll look back and say, oh, this was the beginning of the end or whatever,
That's what I was thinking about that. Our kids are going to ask us, because we're all like, we're probably a little younger than you, and you probably don't have kids, but when we have kids, they're going to be like learning in school, and they're going to ask us like, what was the COVID crash like? Or what was like the aftermath of all that money they pumped out? Like maybe when they're a little older. And we're going to have to tell them, like, well, inflation was crazy because we pumped so much damn money out. Or, we had to wear masks for 2 years straight. Like, all that kind of stuff.
Well, at that time, a can of Coca-Cola, instead of being a dollar in the vending machine, is going to cost us $5. So,
yeah.
McDonald's will be like $8 a cheeseburger at that point.
Let me tell you, Sonny, when I was your age, we could buy a Hershey bar for $1.25. Now it's $20. So, and that's scary, that's really a real, detriment to our purchasing power. And it's, it's actually, it's really sad just what the Federal Reserve has done to our money overall since the Federal Reserve was created. The value of our money has just gone down the tubes, especially since we got off.
We should just barter.
for real. Yo, I got this LaCroix. How much is that worth? Just fucking get some like little tiny Hershey's bar for a LaCroix or something like that.
I'll give you this chapstick.
Everyone needs chocolate, especially when they're depressed. I'm thinking maybe I should just buy 50 cases of chocolate, put it in cold storage. Then when chocolate
that'll
is,
be gold, dude.
Oh, yeah, exactly. When it's really expensive, I'll sell it for just even a little, 25% markdown from what it is in the store, and then bada bing, bada boom.
Okay, yeah. Guys, I have a crazy theory. This isn't okay. So I sent out an outline before we talked to you. This isn't anything on that, but fucking coffee. I think if you can find a way to preserve coffee for like 50 years, you could have like so much money in the future, because I think coffee is going to be so much more expensive.
Well, you know, you can trade coffee futures. I'm pretty sure.
What? You can trade coffee.
I'd have to double check, but I mean, I know you can trade orange juice, you can trade pigs, you can trade cows.
I know you can trade. Oh my goodness.
You can trade corn.
Because I'm convinced that coffee in the future, like we're talking like 40 years, like when we're like 60, 70, 80 years of age, like coffee is going to be like $10 a fucking cup.
Yeah, it already is at Starbucks.
It's not 20, bro.
Yeah.
For real, dude. Have you ever been to a Starbucks? It's like $6 when you go there.
Bro, it's ridiculous.
I'm convinced that it's going to be like triple, because the more people we get, the more people are going to want coffee, the less place we're going to have to grow coffee, because there's going to be more people taking up more space, less coffee. I mean, that's with all agriculture, but I think coffee is like one of the most desirable. I have some massive theory. I don't know if any of you guys remember my lumber theory from like,
yes,
from like 6 months ago. I was on some lumber kick, but I'm convinced coffee is going to be like the biggest thing come like 30 years down the future.
So you can buy it. It's backslash KC.
Coffee backslash futures. KC.
Yeah. So you can trade coffee futures. So
there you go.
Teddy's gonna he's leaving the options world. He's gonna become a coffee futures.
I'm gonna become a millionaire from this. A billionaire. A trillionaire from fucking backslash KC.
Yeah. That's so funny. There you go.
That's hilarious.
That's funny. Shark, I had a question. I don't know how much you want to touch on it, really. But what do you feel like? What's going on with the state of FinTwit, quote unquote, at the moment? Do you pay attention? I know. I don't ever know. I don't know.
Let me pour some more wine. Sensitive subject or a touchy subject.
I think you pay attention. You have to pay attention.
What kind of wine is that? First off, what kind of wine is that?
No, you know.
Oh, that's probably expensive. Special.
No, you know, I went cheapo today, honestly, this damn inflation. No, it's actually just like, it cost me like $12, but it's actually a really good red blend. But it's a really good.
That looks expensive. Really good,
honestly, it's $12, but it's actually like really drinkable. I've been buying too much craft beer recently, and I'm not really like a huge beer drinker, but I've just been getting into those resins, the 6 point. You guys know those? Yes.
I know exactly, dude.
Yeah, those things are dangerous.
Dude, this is
the little 6 of them is $15, and I've just been like going to town on them, and I'm just like, all right, dude, I need to chill out and just get like. You know, I need to just get a little cheap bottle of wine.
That's what.
Yeah. But no, FinTwit is, you know, it's been interesting. I definitely see. I don't follow all the people that have been a part of the whole controversy or anything like that. I mean, I got out of the small caps world because I didn't really like some of the stuff that might have gone on behind the scenes and just the manipulation. I mean, of course, large caps get manipulated too, you know, but from bigger traders and, you know, someone with, 100,000 followers or 50,000 followers is probably not going to influence a stock price on, you know, Apple. You know, I think I posted something in January. I was like, oh, like, can you imagine if FinTwit was like this all year round? Like, everyone was so positive and like supportive, and they were like, yeah, new year, like, mm-hmm. we're gonna kill it and all this, you know.
And went to shit fast.
And now they're all like, killing each other.
Yeah.
I'm older. I don't have time for that bullshit. The most important thing to me is like how I'm trading, like, people that I work with and, you know, the sharks that I work with and who I care about. Like, so it's funny, but,
yeah, it's funny, but it's sad, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I have no idea. 'Cause people can make like a lot of bad calls, but then they still get worshipped in some weird way. I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I'm not into like the whole, and I think Tony, you're big into this too, like the whole like not really like not, like this is my flex, like I made some good homemade food, you know, all that kind of bullshit is just like, you know, jerk jerk off service and, you know, with all the fancy stuff, and that's not reality. And, you know, I'm kind of like the same way. Yeah. Like, okay, I make like, okay, oh, good money or whatever, but I'm not like going crazy all the time, or I don't feel a need to do that. I mean, there's other like psychological things that could be, you know, going on with people that, have the need to do that. I don't know. Like, but it just, it is what it is. I just, everyone, you know, when people are losing money, obviously they get more like emotional or touchy, and it's hard. Like, you know, people say buy the dip, but then the dip keeps dipping, and they don't talk about what I think a lot of options traders and Teddy, we tapped on this, and I've been seeing a lot of Tony, like you're a great post too, just being more focused on education and talking about risk management and position sizing and not averaging down, you know, and cutting losers and just the real things that like make real trading and like, you know, the real shit, like not, you know, not just, you know, oh, I'm buying this dip and then it keeps dipping and then saying something, you know, 3 weeks later, oh, you know, everything went down or whatever, you know, and okay, well, that was like, this post was kind of a little overdue there.
yeah, or something goes down 50% and then a week later it bounces back 10% and then somebody has something to say about it. Like, you shouldn't still be in that. It's
you did not get your average all the way down there, sir.
Yeah.
I just feel, I mean, again, like, I'm not okay. Go ahead. Sorry.
Oh no, I was just gonna say, I just feel like, to a certain extent, when you have a certain amount of people that follow you, you have to be like self-aware of what your tweets or what your actions have on other people. Like, I don't tweet plays. I will never tweet plays. There's no reason. Like, why would I?
Yeah.
That's, I don't know. I just feel like.
No, I mean, it does take, you know, it does take some cojones to put your, you know, you put your plays out there, to put yourself out there, you know. I don't alert. I was thinking about that recently. I was like, oh, should I alert some like intraday day trades? But like, if I'm not, you know, like in the tank, I'm there more like I'm on voice and I'm talking through the plays that could change in a second, or, you know, it's hard. And I'm really impressed by some of these people that like Ripser, he can like post charts like while he's trading throughout the day. It's like, I can't do that. You know, I can't be in a trade and do all those things. Plus this, like, you know, I don't know how they do. Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of responsibility if people, you know, put, you know, follow you, and you hope that they know proper risk management, and they don't go heavy. I mean, at the same time, hey, if you're taking a trade off of what someone says on Twitter, you know, then obviously, like, too, like, you know, what do you expect at the end of the day?
A lot of the people in my Discord are people that got burned by the Twitter stuff. It's people that got burned by call outs or whatever, and they blew an account up, and they actually finally are ready to like learn.
Yeah.
And I think that's that like vicious cycle of stuff. And trying to alert swings now is like super irresponsible.
Yeah.
It's the market is so indecisive, and there's no indication that we should be putting swings out in the air. I don't know.
Especially small caps, bro. Small caps have no room to be a swing unless it's basically like a little pop off a bottom, or, you know, a little pullback on it. Like, it should be like a 5 or 10% swing trade. There's no room to be trading like something saying it's going to double, triple right now, because we have no idea what the market's going to do. In my opinion, SPY and the market are pretty bearish right now. That daily candle is nasty. CPI was nasty. This pullback, not looking good. So I don't think there's any room to be alerting small cap swings right now, in my opinion.
Yeah. It's definitely a tricky, you know, market to navigate. But again, that's why, you know, like I said, I stress to probably everybody, you know, the way you can handle that is, you know, definitely sizing down. It's not like it was 2 years ago, you know, right after COVID, where I was okay with pushing the size. You know, we were in a hot market for a year, a little over a year.
Could throw money at
anything. Okay, then you could just, but it's not that time, and you got to know when to step on the gas and when to take your foot off the gas. And, you know, to deal with the volatility, it's definitely take the foot off the gas, because, I mean, we were seeing SPY go from, 447 to 451 to, to all the way back down to 456,
That's why I think too now, like this time is like that's why I've been like pushing out like a bunch of threads a week on my Twitter, because I think this is like, I mean, for the people that will take advantage of it, like this is the prime time to learn. Mm-hmm. If you're not trading, a lot of people aren't trading right now because they can't navigate the market. This is the time to learn. When you have some downtime,
you can get it through this market, then you can you'll be good. But no, dude, I really respect both you guys for putting out. And I think I touched on this with Teddy last time. You know, you guys are putting out some great educational material, some great posts. And I've often been dealing with this and like feel guilty about it because, maybe it's just because I'm not a young buck anymore. But, you know, it's like, okay, after I'm done with the market, it's like so draining. And then to go back into it and to be posting and doing more charts, it's like, oh, my brain is like dead, dude. I need to get away from it and chill. At the same time, I end up thinking about the market anyway, because that's the way it is when you're kind of obsessed or in love with something. But I often kind of deal with a feeling of guilt, because I see you guys, and I commend you both for putting out such great educational material and threads, like you say. And then I'm like, okay, I need to do more of this, but it's like, I need to also save my own mental real estate to get away and just be like, okay, I need to do something else or go outside or just go talk to people instead of looking at little bars on the freaking
dude. It's hard sometimes. Like, I'll be up 16 hours at my desk. I'm like, it's like midnight. I'm like, what the hell was I just doing?
Yeah.
Like you just feel like, I don't know.
For real. I know that sometimes like I'll be sitting here for way too long, and then all of a sudden like my head will just be like, stop. Like I'll just like get like this like weird like feeling in my head. It's like, oh, I'm so tired.
Dude.
And then it's
I let my dog like, out.
Get the fuck out of here.
I let my dog out the other day. This is gonna sound terrible. Like I let my dog shit a pee. I let her out the back door. I come in and it's like 45 minutes later. I forgot she was outside. It's like noon. I'm like, oh my god.
Where are you again? Is it cold where you are?
Yeah, Pennsylvania. It's cold.
So you were lucky. Bring in like a popsicle.
She loves it. She loves it honestly. But like, I forgot. I'm like, that can't happen. She loves that.
All right, Shark. I got some. I got some fun questions for you. Gotta eat this cherry real quick.
What was that?
What kind of shark would you be? It was a cherry.
Oh.
What might be?
See, I saw this on the gym. Didn't we talk about this though on our first one? I was wondering about that.
I'm not sure.
I feel like we did.
Someone asked me.
No, I know. Well, it's gotta be great white, dude. I mean, there's their one and only. It's gotta be.
The one and only. Have you heard about that like megalodon?
Megalodon.
Oh, yeah. Megalodon.
Megalodon. The big ass thing that some people think is still alive in the bottom of the ocean.
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah. It's that definitely would be, I don't know if we were going into the prehistoric times, but that thing was like a beast. That thing was like as big as a school bus. It was like four times the size of the
The ocean's terrifying.
But
I'm still scared of the ocean.
But no, man, definitely the white shark, sure. I mean, that's just the apex predator. I mean, sharks are just awesome. I mean, they've been around since the dinosaurs. They are like, they have like the best immune systems. They don't get cancer or anything. They're such fascinating and cool creatures. A lot of people hate on them, but actually, all sides of like the food chain are like equally important. So it's like, we actually need those top predators to keep the balance, within the oceans. Cause if we don't have sharks, then, other things get out of whack, and then it messes up the whole, the whole ecosystem. So, I think they're, obviously a bit misunderstood, but I love Jaws too, the movie, of course, like anyone, but of course that added into the bad rep of sharks. Their brains are so small, honestly, they don't know their own power. Like
a great white shark, I'm eating.
They could break through those steel cages. Like when you dive, you know, like they could get, and if they wanted to ram into it, but they don't know, you know. So
I think they just swim around and go chomp, 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 chomp in their head.
Maybe they don't speak
English.
They only think about
you know, sex, food, and
how do sharks have sex? Is one upside down?
You know, the guys in the tank will laugh, but actually, you know, male sharks have two male members. Actually, they have
two.
They've got two.
Damn, I want to be a shark.
They're double dicked up.
So that's because sometimes, like, if I ever play Spy long and short in the same day, we're always like, oh yeah, we double donged it. You
know, I just googled shark sex and the first video that came up is violent shark sex,
bro.
There we go. That's how we get maybe that's not the best thing to say, but yeah, that's how we get down.
That's funny.
All right, man.
No, but sharks are awesome. White shark for sure, but well, sharks are pretty cool. Mako's are cool. They're like the fastest shark.
What's the one that's a big one? The whale shark.
Yeah, which is interesting. The biggest shark actually eats plankton. You know, which there's something to be said for that too. You know,
it has like the strainer in its mouth, so it can't eat. It can't eat big stuff.
You ever see the thing? It was that woman. I don't know if it was a whale shark or it was just a whale, but she was kayaking and got swallowed by a whale and got out.
That was terrifying. It pooped her out afterwards. Dude, she was alive, dude.
Imagine that.
I never heard. I heard of a guy getting swallowed by a whale once, but I don't think he got actually digested. I don't know if that's possible. Is that real? I figure if you actually go into the stomach, there's stomach acids there in there.
Did she go all the way in? There's a video of it. There's a video.
She got for getting pooped out.
No, I don't think she got pooped out. I think she got was in its mouth and it let her go in a kayak.
Let me look it up.
I'm pretty
sure. Two kayakers.
We are going off the.
Well, we started this with nipples and sprinting, so.
No, dude, because I remember seeing her getting straight and eat. Like, she got fucking like.
It's a different thing.
Fucking. Oh, no. It let her out. It said. She got swallowed. Okay, listen to this. And she said, quote, I thought, oh no, it's going to eat me as I was in its mouth.
Yeah, there's a video
and then
of it.
No. But she's like, they like, oh no. She like, they like, questioned her afterwards. She said, I thought, oh no, it's going to eat me as I was inside its mouth. And all of a sudden, I was lifted up inside a big water, and then she thought the whale was going to crush her, but then it let her go. I thought, wow, I didn't get eaten.
I'd never step foot in the ocean again.
Dude, that's
I'd go buy a lottery ticket after that.
Yeah, literally.
If you escape death like that, then you'd be like, all right, it's my lucky day. I'm buying some lottery tickets.
Did you see the thing? It was that dude. I don't know if you guys saw the new Jackass movie.
Get punched in the nuts?
No, they were recording one of the stunts for the thing. The dude was like getting pulled on a boat on a wakeboard or something and ramped sharks. And he actually accidentally fell in and they like bit his fingers off.
Oh my.
In the new Jackass
goodness.
Movie. Yeah.
I'm Googling that too.
I don't think Jackass they put it in the movie, but.
Bit fingers. Oh my goodness. Yep. No, his fingers are gone. I see an image immediately.
Imagine.
Of his hand.
Imagine.
That's terrifying. I gotta ask you quick, Shark. I know you're a UFC guy. We got Whitaker versus Adesanya.
Oh, you like UFC?
Weekend.
I didn't know that.
Shark's the UFC guy. Yeah. Who you got this weekend? I think Adesanya is gonna win, but I'm the biggest Robert Whitaker nut hugger of all time. I love that dude. But I just think he's gonna get knocked out and I'm gonna be fucking sad. Who do you got?
Right. Yeah, no, like yeah, probably Izzy's got the just the technicals just to be able to because Whitaker, he's not a brawler per se. I mean, he's got some decent like technical, you know, stand up, but you know, he comes with those overheads, like, you know, the jab. I think I don't know who's got the longer reach, but I think the jab is going to dictate, you know, but Izzy's just that sniper with his, just a great counter puncher. Did they fight before? I don't remember.
Yeah. Izzy knocked him out.
Yeah.
Because he's got like a longer reach. And I remember Whitaker came into that first fight kind of just like winging big punches because he thought he was going to knock out Izzy.
That's what I'm saying. And then, yeah, he's just going to go straight up the pipe and just get him knocked straight right. So, but, you know, we've seen some interesting upsets, you know, with Amanda Nunes and Juliana. You know, we saw her lose the title. So, I mean, everyone's got a puncher's chance. But, yeah, I mean, the safe bet is on Adesanya more than likely. But I can never deny a good risk to reward, so I usually always end up betting on the underdogs because it's just always a better payout.
Yeah.
It's like, why am I going to bet, you know, $50 or whatever to make, you know, 60, but if I bet 50 to make 100, okay, I'll take that, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
It's the same as trading.
Yep.
And the other thing, too, is like, Whitaker is just so much more likable than Izzy. Izzy's just kind of annoying.
No, I know. Yeah.
He used to not be like that.
I don't like that cocky. Like, that's the reason I kind of not a McGregor fan, because I don't really like that cockiness, you know, kind of thing. And Adesanya definitely has that. But, I mean, but he is good. I don't know, for whatever reason, it doesn't bother me as much with Adesanya.
Yeah. At least McGregor used to back it up. Now it's just kind of getting out of hand.
No. Now McGregor he's gone past.
Yeah.
He's crazy now, man. Like, when he was laying on the side of the octagon, looked like a crazy man yelling like crazy stuff. Dude, he got his ass beat.
That Khabib loss really fucked him up.
For real. I saw Khabib talking about that. He basically said McGregor is happy that ref was there, or else what happened if ref not there? Yeah, he was like, I would have killed him. And I was like, holy shit, dude, he's for real. He would have fucking killed that dude.
Yeah. Sharka, a question I had is, I can't remember if we asked you this last time, but if you want to touch on your specific strategy, you don't have to go too in-depth, but are you more of a scalp weeklies kind of guy in terms of when you're trading options? What do you like to trade? Do you have a few favorite things you'd like to trade? I know for me, I have two, three things that I always look to trade.
I recently kind of narrowed my list down at the start of the year. One of my things was I told myself that, you know, I wanted to only like make a list about 10 tickers. I think I got about 12 on them right now, but I think I'm going to take one of them off. I think I'm taking off CCL. But I made like a list of ones that are usually pretty liquid, like SPY, of course, like my main bay. Microsoft, Apple's got great liquidity, AMD, Snap. These are all ones that have like pretty good ATR, where, you know, you can see a good 4%, except for Apple, I guess, but I like the liquidity on Apple.
Mm-hmm.
They have a pretty good range, you know, intraday. You know, we've seen Lucid do, you know, 8% days in either direction. You know, AMC, I think, is on my list now, is on my list as well. You know, we've obviously seen that do 15% days, 12% days. So I like, you know, things with good liquidity, good range. SPY, I like, because I like trading the market. It's just kind of, you know, kind of cool and just something that I'm just into. And then as far as, what was the other part of your question? Oh, like a strategy?
Yeah, like, I forget if we asked you this last time, but is there any, I know everybody's different, but maybe if you just want to touch on your strategy a bit.
I think I consider myself like a price action trader, you know, based on technicals and supply and demand, which I know that you've been talking a lot recently in a lot of your posts, you know, using those for entries or exits or shorts and things like that, you know, shorting into supply or buying into demand, things like that. But really, I was actually doing some mentorship with somebody, and I was kind of thinking about this recently and just like asking myself, like, okay, like, now you've been doing this for almost like, you know, over a little over half a decade, like, who are you as a trader? You know, because I've tried it, I've dabbled or looked into everything, you know, every single indicator, you know, Fibonacci's and, you know, the RSI and MACD and every indicator I probably looked at or had on my chart at one point or another. Mm-hmm. But really at the end of the day, you know, I think supply and demand, you know, was great. I've been doing a lot of, you know, research into, you know, like accumulation and distribution of the Wyckoff stuff as well. And then really the volume and the tape is, and the patterns is kind of really what I base my trades on. And then after that, I would say that, I'm like an EMA trader, you know, moving average trader, because, you know, those provide great entries, but those also provide great tools to be able to manage your trade, you know, whatever time frame you get on, as long as that baby's riding, you know, the nine on a longer time frame, then I'm still trying to stay in the trade for as long as I can. Of course, I don't always hit the top, you know, that's impossible, you know, or, you know, I don't always hit the bottom. But I really find those helpful to, once I'm in the trade, to be able to manage them, you know, like if I get a 10 minute or a 15 minute close, but you know, under an EMA, okay, that's it, I'm out, you know?
Yeah.
And then I know the short term, you know, trend is broken. And then I might look back later, you know, to see if it's a strong stock on the day, like, you know, I'll look back later on a longer time frame, like a 30 or an hourly, and see, you know, what is this thing kind of doing, you know, at 1 o'clock or 12:30. But I kind of touched on this with Teddy the first time that we recorded this. Like the best trading to me is I'm like a big believer in the KISS, like keep it simple, stupid situation. Like you just need like a couple of things and that's it. You know, a lot of new traders, they'll pile on tons of indicators and all these kind of, all these fancy things. And then also, you know, what you could get into is like an analysis paralysis. So, well, you know, the RSI is overbought, but it's not at the 61 fib retracement and it's not here, so I can't just take overload. The trade, you know, and then, you know, so you have 10 different reasons why you can't take it, and 3 different reasons why you take it. Mm-hmm. You know, I think we brought it into pizza, but we kind of did bring the analogy into old fashions too, which is my favorite drink, and since we all like to drink, I think we'll keep it on the old fashioned side. But the reason I like old fashions so much is because I what is it, 3 ingredients, you know, and they have to, you know, for a great old fashioned, like, you know, they have to be blended together in the right way,
the perfect way.
Yeah, but it's only 3 ingredients. It's not like some fancy cocktail bars or some, you know, drinks you can get that they try to cram 7 ingredients, or even, you know, gourmet, upscale food, you know, where they try to cram in a bunch of different ingredients. You don't even know what you're tasting or what is what, you know, or what's going on. Show me, you know, 3 simple things, put them together succinctly, and you know you've got a recipe for something great. But once you try to pack too much stuff in, you're going to again get that analysis paralysis and waiting for some type of signal, which of course the indicators are all lagging anyway, so you're going to be waiting, so by the time you see the signal it's probably already too late, you know. And I think I mentioned this on another podcast a lot of time. There's different ways to trade, of course, like, but the analogy that I had made was kind of about breakout trading. Like if you're buying the breakout, you know, I'm selling into your strength, you know, more than likely, but I'm not going to buy the breakout ever, you know. I'm going to wait for, you know, a retest after it breaks over or something like that. So, you know, keeping it simple is really the most important thing, and the thing that I really stress to traders. Find, you know, and just because EMAs work for me or doesn't mean that Fibonacci's are completely invalid or that the other things are invalid, because those might work for somebody else. You know, someone might just not be able to wrap their hands. And that's not saying that they're, you know, lesser than or greater than, but it's all what works for your personality, you know, your personality preference, or what molds best with you. But I really price action the tape level two, like you said, supply and demand, accumulation, distribution, and then using those EMAs to manage my risk. But I mean, I'm definitely a big, you know, I've taken plenty of trades off of, you know, VWAP or off the nine on the 15 or on the 30 or something like that. Are great trades. You have that defined risk, you know, a 10 minute candle closes under, you're out, you're risking 20 cents, 30 cents. So that's like 20% on your trade. That's fine.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I know we talked about pizza too. It's three ingredients.
Don't forget about the pineapple on the, you know, the controversial subject. You know, forget about the pineapple, forget about the buffalo chicken with the hot sauce. I mean, that's great, but a great pizzeria is going to give me a great crust, great marinara, a great cheese. That's all you need, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Then, cheese pizza, so. Baby. You might be able to get away with a pepperoni. I'll accept a pepperoni. Right. You get a little bit of a topping in there. But anything more than a pepperoni, it's a little too much for me to actually.
I don't want to hear it. You were talking about some crab fucking Rangoon pizza with eggs on it, bro.
Well, I don't
know. No. There's no crab plus egg. It's water.
That's disgusting.
There's breakfast pizza and there's crab Rangoon pizza. But
just make sure you don't be kissing anybody after having crab pizza. But actually, there's a place in Connecticut that has, I forget the name of it, that has the best crab pizza. I'm not a big seafood person, actually, personally, but I wish I remember the name. But actually, I hear that crab on pizza can be quite good. There's this one spot in, like, I don't know if it's Fairfield or I think it's in New Haven, but it's like really famous.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, like Portnoy or whatever has been there, and like but I don't know, crab on pizza.
Where in New York are there any good places by you?
In New York?
Yeah, like,
come on,
well,
dude. We're the capital of pizza.
I know there, I mean, but like by you, are you, I don't know where you're at. Are you right in the city?
No, yeah, famous definitely ones. Yeah, DeFara is great. L&B's Pomone Garden is great, but that's kind of, L&B's is like further south Brooklyn. But that's great. You got to get the square pizza there. It's like absolutely incredible. The dough's like, forget about it. DeFara is good. They got what's the real famous one? It's like with something with a J, Giuliani's. I'm forgetting. I've been in Florida for like 3 months, so escaping the cold. And what's the name of it? Gianni's? Well, the New York people are going to hate me because I'm forgetting the names of this. But no, there's a million great places in the city for sure. But off the top of my head, definitely L&B, definitely DeFara. That's kind of like a lesser known one. That's really good. But yeah, man, I mean, it's all over. What's the, there's one on by Washington Square Park, I think Joe's Pizza. That's another classic.
Yeah. Teddy needs some real pizza. He's on that.
I got Casey's. I got that gas station shit.
No,
bro. You don't even know what like real pizza tastes like.
I got that gas station pizza. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
Oh, God. That's a catastrophe.
All right. Shark, I know we talked about this on the episode that is unaired, the forever forgotten episode, the lost episode, but trees, man. This is the last thing we got to talk about. Why are there not as many trees in cities as there should be? There's so much green space in cities. Why are there not more trees? I get upset because I live in a city. I live in a decently large city. I know you live in a way bigger city than I do. And I don't know about you. You live in a city. I don't know if it's bigger.
I do not live in a city. I live in a ass crack town in the middle of nowhere.
But why are there not more trees, bro? Like,
how far are you away from Philly?
2 hours.
Okay.
I'm 2 hours from New York as well, so I'm right in the middle.
Oh, shit. Okay. You're close to New York.
Do you have an Amtrak that comes into the city? You have a...
Yeah.
An Amtrak line?
Yeah, oh, it's okay. Like...
You guys got Amtraks out there?
Well, it's like a 20-minute drive from me, but it takes you both ways.
Now, before I answer the tree picture question, I have to also give a shout out to Pauly G's, because that's in where in my hood at Greenpoint. So Pauly G's definitely is another shout out for some great pizza. They do great Neapolitan. So that's another one that I have to give a quick quick shout out to. But I'm trying to look up. I can't believe I'm forgetting the name, because there's actually. There's like a pizza war that actually goes on with these like, they have like, you know, like old secrets, you know, from like that they bring from like, you know, Naples from like 1800, you know, like 90 from their grandma, you know, and they have these battles over these recipes. Okay, I remember Grimaldi's. That's the name of it. Grimaldi's is the other famous one. It's in Dumbo. But then they had like a fight, but someone had like some internal fighting, and then they opened up another place, which is now like they call it Giuliana's, but it's like, it's actually the legit Grimaldi's. And now, but Grimaldi's still exists, but it's like supposedly not the same as like as like the official. So they're like right next to each other too. So Grimaldi's and Giuliana's is like the other two places.
That's a real war.
Is it like crazy wait times in the city for pizza?
Yeah, depending on where you go. Yeah, like Grimaldi's and Giuliana's definitely could have it. But another good one is Roberta's. That's another good one.
Like if I wanted a pizza, am I talking like more than like an hour?
For in like the place Roberta's in Bushwick in Brooklyn, yeah, that like sometimes like on a Saturday night, you could definitely be waiting like 45 minutes to an hour.
There's a place by me.
I mean, I don't know how it is now.
There's a place by me. It's actually very good. And whenever you call, it's 4 hour wait.
Hey, dude, I don't got that issue with my gas station.
Yeah.
Mine's right up the fucking road. My gas station is 10 minutes away. They get it to me in 30 minutes. I'm just saying, right. Gas station 30 minutes.
No, we need more trees in the cities, man. I think that well, obviously, you know, the reason there are more trees is because real estate and money makes the world go round. So the real estate is just, you know, so precious here that that people just you know, people are clamoring from that spot. But I think New York does a pretty decent job. There's some great parks, obviously Central Park and Washington Square Park, although there's not many trees there, but you get that arch, Madison Square Park. But I think there should be more trees. You know, I think I'm gonna have to write the council about that, you know, and write a strongly worded letter, because, you know, we need that life in the city to kind of counteract the concrete jungle. But, you know, in the city, sometimes I'll say, like, the people are the nature instead of the trees. That's what you get. So,
yeah, I mean, you got to write Des Moines. We got no fucking
trees.
That's what we were saying last time.
That's what we were saying last time. I think that if I write New York City Council, of course, nothing's going to happen. I mean, I might tell them, you know, hey, like, you know, I'm Shark from Twitter. Like, you should, you know, hey,
put up some trees, dog.
Yeah, like, you know, you should know what's up. Like, you know, but I think we have a better chance of maybe getting some more trees in Des Moines.
How do you not have trees there?
You should run for mayor.
I'm gonna run for mayor, and then I'm gonna put up some damn trees. Slappy gang gonna get the trees up. And there's some trees, but like I mean, I go through downtown, and like there'll be like a tiny tree, and then I'll go like a mile, and there's one more tiny tree. Like they just got these little ass trees, and it's all just concrete. Other than that, like
you know what?
There's not
actually,
a lot of trees.
I got a good story for you guys. Do you know actually? This is good. You know, Wall Street. The origins of Wall Street in the city, there was a small, where the Wall Street Stock Exchange is now. The first transaction actually was done under a small buttonwood tree at Wall Street where it is. The tree isn't there anymore, but that's actually where the first transaction ever happened in that area. And they made some type of agreement in that area. And that's kind of like where that area of Manhattan kind of became like the epicenter for like commerce.
That's cool as fuck.
Which is, yeah, which is pretty kind of cool and, you know, interesting that the first, you know, transaction happened under this little tree under there. And yeah, now it's the, you know, the epicenter of everything that we do. So, you know, it's pretty cool.
That's kind of a crazy way to think about it. Like, we started under a tree. Things grew all the way to the point of having computers, and then things grew all the way to the point of me selling a stock to you within a second, you buying the stock from me, selling it back within another second, like whatever it is. Wow. It came from a tree of like talking for hours, days, however long it was, bro. Like you had to talk for fucking days. And then be like, we're gonna meet under this tree, fucking shake hands, and that's the transaction. And now it's like, all right, I'm gonna sell this. I click my hotkey, it sells it to you, and then you decide to sell it, and then a second later yours is sold. That's weird. That's super weird.
Yeah, I think I'm trying to remember because this is testing my history, but yeah, it was like back in like 1792 or something crazy like that. No, apparently I'm trying to look it up here. Apparently the tree's still there somewhere. That's just what I'm reading here. That
it's still there.
The tree is somewhere.
It's gotta be big as fuck, dude.
It's still sitting in front of the stock exchange facing Wall Street. Yeah. I'm going to have to go down there. I haven't been down there since I've really been back in New York from Florida. So I'm gonna have to go down there and take some pictures see what the vibe is. But it's very interesting because, you know, also like what we're doing, the transaction, you know, is like a form of human intimacy, you know, like you give, I take, you give, you know. Unfortunately, we always have to remember for every time that we win a trade, someone else is losing a trade. Yeah. You know, that's how the market works. So it's interesting. It's a kind of you know, like we were talking about before with FinTwit, it's and kind of like the whole, you know, the whole flashy kind of one side of it. At the same time, like that transaction of money is like a real weak side, like a weak form of human interaction, you know, in intimacy, you know, because we are so much more than that, you know, what we can give to each other. I'm gonna find that tree, and when I do, I'm gonna tag both you guys because I'm gonna go try to find it. That'll be my task because the weather's getting a little better. It was 50 degrees today, which I was really really happy
it was
about.
Freezing here.
It was nice here.
I can't believe you don't have trees there, bro. I have like there's so many trees here. Again, I'm not in a city, but
there's fucking no trees. Like, people will put like a baby little tree in their yard and think that that's like, oh, dude, I'm so green and I'm so green thumbed. Yeah. Nah, man. Like, I want to see like a literal city in a forest. Like, that's what I hope for is trees. Like, I'm talking like 10 trees in everybody's yard. Like, 10 trees.
Well,
have
you been to New York? You got to come. I mean, well, Central Park is like completely fake because it was built, you know, like, but, you know, we kind of have a forest. Also, Prospect Park in Brooklyn is actually even more, it's like you can definitely get lost and not hear, like, the cars going by.
Oh, dude, that's what I want. I'm going to come to New York. I want to eat some pizza and get lost in that forest because, man.
Let's go, dude. We'll drink some 99-cent apples. We got
for real. All three of us can get together, bro. You're 2 hours away.
Oh yeah, and so yeah, Ant's got no excuse. It's all on Teddy now. Whenever
yeah, you're the one that's far.
Coming in April, man. When the weather starts changing, dude, for sure.
We're gonna hang. I want some pizza. I want some trees. I want some New York fucking some parks. I want some just genuine feelings of New York. I want to just get those roots of New York. But man, that'd be awesome. We should actually do that. Me and Ant head out to New York sometime in the springtime, hang out with Shark.
Yeah, you could do a like a halt get together, like, you know, because I'm sure you guys have some listeners in New York, and you could say, you know, whoever wants to come and have a drink, you know, and come hang out and that hang out fun. For a couple hours, something like that.
We should totally do that. Just
because Teddy and I have never met.
Nah, we for real never met.
So.
Oh, wow.
Well, this we're too far away.
How many episodes have we ran without ever meeting? Is this episode like 25? Yeah.
Not that many.
Well.
Yeah. 25
come
episodes.
30, you guys have to get married. That's kind of like legal.
I feel like we got to kiss on the mouth at like.
Yeah.
Yeah, your girlfriend's gonna have to just.
She's gonna be like, hey.
Hey, well. All right.
That's cool.
All right, Shark Man. We want to thank you a ton for coming on. This was awesome. I'm sure our listeners will learn a ton and enjoy it. So thank you. Thank you a ton.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. Again, I love what you guys are doing and contributing to the community on FinTwit. I think it's really admirable and great and making me feel like I need to do more. But that's good because, you know, we all got to push ourselves to be better in whatever ways that we can. So, I thank you so much for having me. And next season, we'll have to do another.
Oh, you're on every season now.
Yeah, you're a staple.
You're committed.
And and once the weather changes, come over to New York, and we'll have a halt get together.
That would be so fun.
We're gonna do it now. Now that you said it, it's happening.
You could probably
in the spring.
You could probably actually fly to me because there's an airport like 30 minutes, and it's super cheap.
Oh, dude, I will.
It's called Avoca.
Avoca. All right, I'm going to fly straight to your fucking ass. You're going to have to house me.
It's like 30 minutes from me.
And then we're going to Amtrak to New York, meet Shark, meet all the motherfuckers that listen to The Halt. It's going to be dope.
Yeah, that would be fun.
Yeah, let's do it, brother.
All right.
All right, guys. Well, have a great night. Thank you so much again. And trade safe out there. Make sure, you know, the new traders size down while you take care of the volatility. And be safe.
Thank you.
Respect your risk.
Yes, sir.
You too, bro. Have a good
one,
man.
All right, guys. Trade safe.
See ya.
We'll see you soon.
CLSK. They just had a good earnings, I think. Let me look at this. They beat EPS by 80%. They, like, pretty much matched revenue. They missed revenue by, like, $100,000, but their reported was, like, $41 million, so it doesn't really matter how much they missed by there. But I've been seeing a lot of hype about it on Twitter. I've been seeing people talking this could be the next like big mover because CLSK, when it moved last year and the year before, it moved. Like this thing follows trend pretty well. And it looks like it's trying to flip trend right now because it was in a pretty big downtrend from $22. They offered and then it bottomed at $5.50, $5.40, something like that. And then now it's back up at about 9:30. It's had a nice curl here on the daily. It's above the 20 and the 9 averages. It has a nice volume kind of desert until about $11. But for me, the big thing I'm seeing is the 50 MA. It got rejected on and closed below the 50 MA today, which is scary to me. Especially on such a high volume day as in today. Today's volume was 13 million when before that we haven't topped we haven't had more than 4.5 million in like months since August 17th. And it got rejected pretty heavy at the 50 MA, which is scaring me a bit today. So I think I'm going to go bullshit. I think this is just a kind of a momentary pullback. I think it's just going to need to bounce around a bit for now. I don't think we're going to see that 20 number like everyone has been talking about on Twitter. And I also think the fact that it got rejected at the 50 MA as hard as it did with as big of a upper wick as it did today is something that needs to be mentioned and hold some weight. So I'm going bullshit for now.
What is the company?
They're like a green energy company. I know they do some stuff with solar.
Anything, I don't know, anything like green energy, anything EV right now is in a weird spot.
For sure.
Back to that whole, if swings were a thing, it looks half decent. But I don't like that close on the daily, like you said, under the 50. But looking at the overhead, this has a ton of overhead. This has a ton of overhead, and by overhead I mean like resistance areas, using volume profile, that this has up until 15, 14, 15 bucks. You have those 200s sitting at 14-ish. I don't like that close on the daily at all, to be honest. So I'm calling bullshit just technically. And also EV stuff's just in a weird spot.
Yeah, I agree. Also, the other thing I didn't even mention when I was talking about it was if you go back to when it's that August and late September when it double bottomed at like 1080 to 11 bucks. That's exactly where it got rejected today. I think that's a really, really big resistance. That's also where there's a huge volume shelf on the volume profile. So I think that's probably going to be the level that it has to get through. And right now it looks like it has no power to get through. Like when I mean no power to get through, it looks like it needs a pullback to even have a chance.
That's the most volume it's had since March of last year.
Yep. Yeah, for real. Most volume in a year and it could not break resistance.
Also, we've been almost perfect with these picks. I wish your F pick from last week was dude, the day before so it came good. Out because that'd have been crazy.
We both said AMC to 15 and it hit 15 like 4 days after we posted that video. And like we recorded it like a full like 5 or 4 days before maybe like 3 days before we posted it, and it hit 15 like the next fucking week. And then Ford, I don't really know. Facebook, we said had some more downside. It had some more downside. Like we've been balling.
What else did we do? Like Nvidia, I think AMD or something.
We did Nvidia, and I had a pretty strong thesis that it was not bullish, and everyone was bullish on it. And then it broke down. I've been trying to post those individual videos because I know a lot of people like to see like a minute clips of us just talking about stuff. But
yeah.
I'll post these ones too because I got a pretty good thesis on the next one. Roblox, RBLX. Nancy Pelosi. The last video. Yeah, dude. The last video we had, I had the Ford earnings and I said they were going to miss, and they had not missed in how long? 2 years?
2 years, I think. Six earnings in a row.
Six earnings. So yeah, like 1.5 years. They'd beaten a lot in a row. Roblox has not beaten earnings one single time since they haven't beaten. Go look at their earnings reports, man. Their earnings report. Let me just read this out to you. Their first earnings report, their estimate was 8 cents. They reported negative 46 cents.
How?
No idea. Their next earnings, their estimate was 12 cents. They reported negative 25 cents. Next earnings, their estimate was 13 cents. What did they report? Negative 13 cents. They have not even been a positive on the EPS when they've been estimated positive every single time. I think you know what I'm about to say, though.
I know
they're going to be positive this time, baby.
Dude. How have they not beat? I hear everyone and their mom talking about Roblox.
Yep, that's why they're going to beat, dude. Everyone and their fucking mom, dad, little brother, little sister.
This is like a 10-year-old's dream, bro. Roblox. Yes,
literally.
And Nancy Pelosi.
Exactly, bro. And also, look at that volume the past. Let me look at that. Since November. Look at that volume since November. Not that it has anything to do with earnings, but that's some nice-ass volume. They're going to be... I'm convinced they're going to be...
Look at the overhead, though. Holy hell. That's something out of a fucking nightmare.
Look at their estimate, though. Their estimate is negative 13 cents.
That's their estimate? Whoop.
They're going to be positive this earnings. Mark my fucking words.
Oh, dude, if their estimate's negative 13.
Yeah, that's what you got to look at. You got to look at estimates, and you got to look at analysts over corrections.
Analyst rating, strong buy.
Yep. They're going to beat earnings, and they're probably going to run all the way to $80.
Wait, I can't believe their EPS is negative.
Yep, for three straight quarters. And that's all the earnings they have. Like, they don't have any other earnings to report because they IPO'd back in March 21. So these are all of their earnings, and they have missed every single time when the estimate has been positive and they've hit negative.
Well, then I'm going bullish on just that.
Yeah, I'm going bullish too. They're going to hit earnings. And I mean, like, people might want to, I don't know, my Ford one, people, I know a lot of people in the Discord and people on Facebook are on Twitter, I got a lot of DMs that were basically saying, like, bro, like, your logic is a little, like, is a little paper thin. And I was like, okay, but we're going to see if it works. And it works, because the thing is you don't have to, like, have, like, a fucking buddy who works for Ford executives. Like, you don't need to know all of that. All you need to know is, are the analysts overcorrecting? Has there been something bullish in the company? And the thing that's bullish about this company is everyone and their fucking kid is talking about it. Every kid I know has like a subscription to this stupid little thing. I don't even know what it is, but I know that all my cousins at family events just talking Roblox, Roblox, Roblox. Like, bro, in between their fucking ham and cheese little like whatever and stuffing at Thanksgiving, all I heard was, do you like Roblox? And I was like, I don't know what that is, but I'm glad you like it. I'm going to buy their stock now.
I don't know what it is either.
I'm going to Google it. What
it's supposed Roblox? To be like Minecraft.
That's exactly what I thought it was, like a Minecraft knockoff. It's like, it looks like some sort of, I'm on Google Images. I'm just scrolling. It looks exactly like Minecraft, like Minecraft plus GTA. Like, bro, it's like, this one is like,
dude, you ever go to the GTA strip club?
Yeah, and then take them home and then you feel bad about your life.
I was like 14 and I was at the strip club and my mom came in. And bro, I didn't have my Xbox for like 3 months.
Oh man, you want to hear something crazy? I wasn't allowed to have an Xbox while I lived in my parents' house.
Why?
They were just real strict about like video games and shit. They didn't believe in it. So I hid one in my sock drawer and I would like plug it in and it was literally a fire hazard. Like I would be like plugging it in and playing it while it was in my sock drawer covered in socks.
All those socks are on it?
Yeah, for real. And I would like shut it off and I have to yank the socks off it because it was like they were like suction cups to
What's
it.
What's that smell, bro? It's a sock.
It literally sometimes smelled like burnt hair in my room because it was fucking sock smell.
How'd you play? Did you lock your door?
It would be late at night and I would like turn the volume all the way down. And I didn't even know Xbox Gold existed at that time because like all my friends were talking and I just like was happy I had an Xbox finally. I was like 17 and I bought one off Craigslist in the Walmart parking lot because my parents didn't let me have one. And I was like, dude, like I finally got an Xbox. And I was just like learning how to play Madden. And I will not, like, I'm not shitting you. Like my thumbs did not work. Like they would like literally like my player would like be running like zigzagging and I would get tackled behind the line every time for like 2 months. My friends made fun of me because we played this shooting game. And I didn't know like how to aim. Like I did not know how to like hold my thumb in the right place. Mm-hmm. It was so embarrassing.
That's why you got to learn like, when you're like 10.
Exactly. They had all been playing for like 10 years because they got them when they were fucking young. And I was like 17 just learning. And so I'd like be, they would literally get me to play and they would just watch me because they thought it was the funniest thing. Like I would literally be like in this like Call of Duty setting and I'd be turning like this. I'd go.
Yeah, look at you now, though. They're all still playing Xbox. And look at you.
Yeah, look at me, motherfucker. I'm fucking...
These thumbs are making money, dude.
Yeah, no, it was funny. We got one last one, though. After all these side hustle talks or side stories. Google. GOGL Alphabet Incorporated. They're doing a stock split. What are they doing? 20 for one? Is that what it is?
It better be, because fucking ain't nobody buying this.
It'll be like at what 3 grand. A 100 and something bucks?
A 20 to 1. Yeah, it'd be 100 something. So it'd be, dude, what's it now? 2.7? It would be
like 103, 104.
Like 135?
Yeah, 130? Something like that. I think that's bullish as hell for them.
Oh, dude, that's, they have to. Like, what, I mean,
maximum bullish.
They can't, I mean, they have no choice.
Yeah, this is, I mean, not, we've seen what
desirable to.
Yeah, I can't trade options on that. Fuck, I have a bigger account than I think most people have, and I don't want to fucking mess with the Google options. The
premiums are on that, yeah.
Yeah, dude, they'd be like, what is Tesla's like $1,000, and the premiums on there are like 20 or 30 bucks sometimes. So this would be like 50 or 60 bucks. So you'd be talking like, oh my goodness.
Yeah, I don't know who's
five grand this. For one. Oh my goodness. I think bullish though, because I mean, as the stock will move slower, like there's going to be a bigger float, but I think it'll also follow trend a little bit better. I think that comes with more shares. I think they follow trend a little better.
Anything that splits like that's bullish.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen Nvidia and Tesla. Those things, boner.
Yeah, we're not talking reverse splits either. We're talking,
yeah,
just a straight
split. Reverse splits are not bullish for anyone listening.
HD.
Not bullish. That was one of my first. That was one of my first big thesis things. AHT.
I remember.
I felt so strongly about that.
Didn't you AHT. Post that on Twitter?
Yeah, that was. Well, it was that one and Lucid happened about the same time. I made a YouTube video about Lucid and how I hated the price that it was at, and then it crashed like the next day, and I felt like a Greek god. Like I thought I was Zeus on fucking Mount Olympus when that thing crashed the next day. Oh my goodness.
Look at Wish.
Dude, someone in my Discord, anytime Wish has two consecutive days green, shorts it.
They're a genius.
Dude, he, like, anytime that there's two or like 2 to 3 consecutive days green, he just buys puts.
And that's
he
says happened 1, 2, 3, 5 times. That's happened five times since November.
Yeah, wow. And he's just made so much fucking money because he always says, like, he holds it for, like, 2 or 3 days after that, and it's always the biggest red candles. Like, it's always, like, a, like, 15% or 20% drop, and he just, like, banks on those puts.
Yeah, he's a genius.
I know. Shout out Booch. Fucking genius on that one. And I mean, it's on three green candles right now, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, I got to go look at SPY, bro. I took some SPY puts overnight. Let me go look at this post. Okay. We're down a decent amount because I've been to do this small account challenge where I take these overnight plays. So, dude, look at this SPY candle. That's a nasty SPY candle.
I have so many supply and demand zones on this. I can't even think straight. I need to clean this up.
I did that. Dude.
People want a supply and demand only podcast episode.
We should definitely do it. We could definitely talk some mad key levels, some supply and demand. Oh my goodness, dude. That is a really gross candle on SPY.
Yeah, look at the 4 hour.
Let me go look at it. Ooh. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, inside bar. Dude, I start, what? Little tip is I start with the 4 hour when I draw my zones. Then I like we'll work my way down. What time frame do you usually use?
When it comes to SPY and like these large caps, I usually, when I go in the morning, because I do all my levels in the morning, and I usually just keep the key ones on my trading. Okay, so this is kind of a complicated answer, actually. So I keep my big levels on TradingView, and I'll keep like the key ones that line up with psych levels and then the daily chart, but they'll start on my 30 minute every morning. So every morning I go on and I do 30 minute and I look for levels, and then I go down to 15 and I look for levels, and then I go down to 5 minute and look for levels. And whichever ones of those stick really, really strong, mm-hmm. I go and put on my trading view on the daily. Like whichever ones I notice have stayed around for 3 or 4 days, whether it's a level, whether it's a just a trend line, I go stick them on my trading view on the daily. And I have like those ones as in like the macro trends. Like I have this one, the double bottom at 427, 426. 427 is probably the level. That one started from my 15 minute chart that I made one morning, and then mm-hmm. it just stayed and stayed and stayed and stayed. And once it stays for like 3 or 4 days, I just flip it over to my daily. I don't know if you understand anything I just said, but
no, I do.
Okay, cool.
I just like, I don't like the daily. I don't like using the daily. So the highest time frame I'll go is the 4 hour. When you use
4 hours, nice, man.
Yeah, you just get like a clear picture. But the thing is with that is if you don't flip to like a lower time frame, like the 15 or something, you may miss it a little bit. So I always like will use the 4 hour and then the 15, and I'll look at the 5. But
yeah,
dude, something I learned today. I don't use Webull. Apparently, VIX on Webull is like 8 minutes behind. So if you pay attention, what? If you pay attention to VIX, it's delayed on Webull. You have to like, somebody in my Discord was saying you have to like contact them to get real time VIX data, which doesn't make any sense. Because I was charting VIX today and I threw my Discord and my buddy texted me and he's like, dude, this is way off. And he was looking at Webull. I'm like, what the hell? And they were all saying, yeah.
Are they trying to like, because I know a lot of people preach that VIX is like the answer to SPY. Like if you can chart VIX, you can trade SPY
and Qs.
Like, are they trying to like fuck you over in that way? Like
make you lose money? I don't know. That doesn't make any sense.
Because I know Webull's VWAP is fucked up.
I'd love to know.
I still use it.
Yeah. I'd love to know their reasoning. Like,
yeah.
Like what's the reason that it's delayed?
That's weird. I've never heard that before.
Yeah, I just found that out today. I don't use Webull, but that's frustrating for people that use Webull.
Damn, bro. I use VIX. Like I have VIX up. I have like kind of three settings on my Webull. One is just like a big chart, and then I have two little charts next to it. That's the main setting I have, where I have these three charts up, and I usually put VIX in one of those little charts, and then like, you know, SPY in one of the other little charts, and then whichever stock or small cap or whatever I'm watching closest in the big chart. But I never knew VIX is delayed on Webull. Yeah, I'm gonna have to fucking figure that out, because I'll understand. Call their ass.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense.
I'll go
sense.
Straight Karen on the ass.
Yeah, dude, he was showing me the chart. I'm like, bro, this is delayed. And like sometimes you get delayed data if you don't subscribe to real-time quotes.
Yeah,
that's
I know
how
that.
TD is. I'm like, bro, are you sure you're on real-time? He's like, no, I'm sure. And I was talking in stream, and they're like, oh, yeah, VIX is delayed on Webull. I'm like, why?
Why would they do that?
I don't know.
Damn, I know that their level 2 costs and stuff. Webull, like, I know they got to pay for their, because they have no, what is it? No commission,
yeah,
or whatever. But they got to pay for it somehow. So maybe that's how they do it. I don't know.
Makes no sense.
Weird as hell.
Yeah, some dude today was trying to, did I tell you about this? Yeah, was trying to tell me VIX didn't matter. Did I tell you this?
No.
I said,
what?
I tweeted something. I tweeted it was VIX next to QQQ. QQQ rejected supply as VIX bounced out of demand. I said, this is why VIX is super important. And I took QQQ puts, and they did well. And this guy's like, dude, said something along the lines of, yeah, well, VIX doesn't really matter. And I said, are you sure? Question mark. And his response was, he screenshotted a picture of my profile picture on Twitter and responded, and it said, enough said. I said, bro, what? I said,
there's some fucking clowns on here, dude.
Like, what?
All what right, does that even bro. Mean? What are you trying to say?
That means I have no argument. I'm just going to fucking do something stupid. Whatever.
People try to people try to do these whole, like, ever since that whole, what was it, ratio thing came out, where you just post ratio under someone's, which, to be honest, it can be really funny sometimes and really, really hilarious. But, like, some people, like, think you can just, like, screenshot. Like, I know I see so much on Twitter where it's, like, someone says something, they get in a little fight, and then someone just screenshots their profile picture and says, this is all I need to tweet. And then it gets, like, 8,000 likes. I'm like, that person is really not that ugly. And, like, I don't know what you're trying to do here, but, like, everyone else thinks it's funny. I'm like, what?
I was laughing. I'm like, bro, what? That's your argument. Like, and then he followed me and I blocked him. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. That's the thing, dude. Good talk, dude. Unfollowing people and muting is key.
You should see my mute and block list. It's at like 200 something.
I mute the fuck out of people if they say some stupid shit that I'm just like, a lot of people I'll be the following, and then all of a sudden I'll see like some like random shit and I'm like, dude, you're just trying to lead your followers on, or you're trying to do some stupid dumbass stuff. I just bam, muted or unfollowed. Sometimes I feel alone, hiding my secrets, you need to know. I cannot feel no more, all of my demons with me at home. I saw you.